once again, welcome to the 2014-2015 Eagle Pass Independent School District Convocation. At this time, I'd like to invite you to turn your attention to the screen for a short clip as our very own secondary student council officers from both high schools describe what it is that makes our district simply the best.
I wonder how I can show my staff that they work for the best district ever.
Take this time to introduce some special guests, and what an honor it is to have our congressman here with us, Mr. Pete Gallego. Pete, stand up, would you? Your board vice president, Ms. Glenna Purcell. Ms. Lupita Fuentes, board secretary. Lucila Martinez, trustee. Mr. Benny Rodriguez III, trustee. And Mr. Ramon Ramirez, trustee. Mr. Ramirez, what up? Thank you all for coming. I know Hector Alvarez wanted to be here. Dr. Alvarez had something to be at. He apologizes, but give it up for Mr. Alvarez. You know, I was coming down those steps, and the only thing that was running through my mind was, don't fall. Don't fall. I know some of you were thinking the same thing. And there's probably a couple of you who were saying, man, I hope he falls. Can you imagine if I did fall? I mean, you'd have me going down, and it'd probably be a lot louder than, but I didn't fall, luckily. But what happens if I did? You know, I'd get myself back up, dust off the embarrassment, and move on. Now let me ask you guys this, and I know I tend to ask you guys a lot of questions. What happens when you fall? Not literally, not here. What happens when things falter? When things start going your way and you get knocked down? Because I think everybody in this room could admit that we've got days like that, where things aren't working out for us and we fail. But who are we failing? Are we failing ourselves? Are we failing our students? And what constitutes failure exactly? You know, I remember a couple of years back, I received a text message from a teacher. And it was around testing time, the scores had just come in. And the scores at that particular campus for that grade level and that subject, well, they weren't that hot. But this teacher texted me and said that felt like a failure. Like they had let themselves down, they had let the district down, and they had let the students down. And while I appreciated the text, I never saw it as a failure, because I knew that teacher, and I knew what that teacher brought to the classroom. And yes, we have high expectations. And yes, we do expect success. But we understand that that comes gradually, and we understand that there's setbacks along the way. Okay? Not gonna be a smooth ride. We understand that. You know, I went back to that teacher recently and asked why they said that, and they said, well, you need to understand that we have high expectations for ourselves because that's what we ask from our students. And I realized that we've already created this culture of success. What you guys have done year in and year out for the last few years is nothing short of amazing. Give yourselves a round of applause for that. That's amazing work. And let me tell you something. The hardest part wasn't getting here. The hardest part is maintaining it. Because now it becomes about adaptation. Now it becomes about methodologies. New methodologies, you've got new mandates, you've got new members, you've got new personalities that you deal with, you've got new infrastructure, you've got new technologies. And all that ties into one another. We know that. So it becomes more difficult every year. From day one, I've told you guys that we're a family, that we're a team. And I will continue to say that. And Mr. Gonzalez, I apologize for what I'm about to say, but I want you guys to know that if anybody's the biggest leaders out here, it's you guys, because you guys are the ones that have the direct interaction with the students on a daily basis. You guys are the leaders, more so than anybody else. But I will tell you this, that as good of a leader as you are, a good leader knows that he can trust his peers. A good leader, a responsible leader, will tell you, you know what, I don't know everything that there is to know. But I know that I can go next door and I can knock on my neighbor's door and my neighbor's gonna be able to help me out. And if she can't, I know that I can go to a department meeting and there's gonna be somebody there with open arms to help me out, to help find a solution. And that's what I'm trying to convey to you guys. Look, we all work as a team. We're all working towards the same goal. And you realize that there isn't failure here because nobody wants to see anybody else fall here, other than myself coming down the steps, but that's neither here nor there. You know, I realize that success is just as subjective of a word as failure. And I'll go back to that teacher thing where I said I didn't feel it was a failure because I knew what that person brought to the classroom. I knew what that person was capable of, despite whatever scores say. So before I leave, I'm going to ask you guys for two things. And I never ask you guys for anything, but I'm asking you for two things this year. And one is that we all resolve to make a difference. Because at the end of the day, when you look past the numbers, when we look past the percentages, when we look past the attendance percentages, when we look past the raw data, I know, I see the Mijares is cringing over there when I'm talking, I apologize. But what matters most to me, and I know what matters most to you, is that we continue to impact these students on a daily basis. And I'm not just talking about a handful, I'm talking about all of them. Because in order To expect success, we have to ensure that we're going to create success for everybody, not just a few. And once you've done that, then you know that you've won. Then you know that you've won your day, you've won your week, you've won your 9 weeks, you've won your semester, you've won your year. And that's what matters. Isad, do me a favor and pull up a clip real quick. Before I leave, I want to show you a clip to illustrate my second point.
We did it.
We did it!
It looked amazing!
Look at that! That looks like what you would buy from a store.
It should have been.
Look at all this floor space.
So much.
Did you do aerobics in here?
So many activities!
Do step class?
It's making my head spin how many activities we can do.
Play arm and leg?
Yeah.
This is how we do it!
Da, 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 da.
Hey, I never asked you.
Yeah.
You like guacamole? Oh! Oh, God! Run! Run! Run!
Thank you, son. So, everything with the exception of the bed collapsing, leave that part to me. Everything else that you saw up there, that's the kind of enthusiasm I want to see. Not as quirky, obviously. But to say, you know what, at the end of the day, we did it. We did it. And this is how we do it. And this is what mantra for Eagle Pass ISD needs to be. This is how we do it. You want to sing along with me? One, two, three. This is how we do it. Give it up, Eagle Pass. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Wish you guys the best of luck. Go out there and get them. Now my distinct pleasure to introduce to you the representative from the 23rd Congressional District. He's your congressman, Mr. Pete Gallego. Come on up, Pete.
Es un placer estar aquí con ustedes. It is such a pleasure to be here. I'm going to ask that we turn the lights on so that we can see you all, because I'm going to ask y'all one quick set of questions. Those of you who are in your first year of teaching, please stand up. Now, those of you who have been teaching between 2 years and 5 years, please stand up. All right. How many of you have been teaching between 5 and 10 years? How many of you have been teaching between 10 and 15 years? How many of you have between 15 and 20 years in the classroom? How many of you have between 20 and 25 years in the classroom? I want to see how many of you have been teaching kids between 25 and 30 years. I know some of you have been teaching between 30 and 35 years. Let's see. Anybody? Anybody have more than 40? That says a lot. That says a lot about your district. That says a lot about your district. I will tell you, you know, I have the privilege of being a congressman, but the most important privilege that I have is being a dad. And my little boy is he's a fourth grader now. And so I can't really meaningfully express how important the job that you do is. Because as a kid, when people would tell me, gosh, you know, you guys are the future, I would laugh and say, see, yeah, right, you tell that to everybody. But you know what? When you become a parent, it's not abstract anymore. It's real. And it is so real that I see it every day, and I see the difference that a teacher can make. And understand that, you know, some kids are easier to teach than others. I was sharing with the board a picture of a family portrait that Marilena and I and Nicolas took, where Nicolas has the single biggest smile on his face that I have ever seen. And then you make the picture a little bigger and you see that he put rabbit ears behind Marilena and me. And so some kids are fun, loving, and enjoyable. Some kids are a little harder to teach. Some kids at home have a really, really difficult life. And so they come to your classroom with all sorts of baggage. But the truth is that every single kid is so important. And every single kid makes such a difference in the future of this country. So what you do day in and day out is incredibly important. For me, I will also tell you that kids keep me... it's important that you always stay grounded. It's important that you always understand that, as your board president has indicated, you have good days and bad, and there are going to be days that you think you're really doing well. And in my life, Eagle Pass has played such a central role. You know, when I got elected to the legislature, it was Eagle Pass that put me over the top. And when I got elected to Congress, it was Eagle Pass that put me over the top. But I will also tell you that one of the single best grounding lessons, and the superintendent and I were talking earlier, the single best grounding lessons that I've ever had was in Eagle Pass. I'm kind of passionate about this one particular elementary school in Texas. And so I will tell you quickly that day, the day that that school was dedicated, was a phenomenal day for me. I had my parents here, my sisters, you know, Marilena and I, and it was I was feeling really good, right? I mean, gosh, that's kind of a cool feeling. And so I'm walking down the hall, they're giving me a tour of this brand new school, and this little first grader comes out. I saw her later, years when she was actually in high school. And she comes out of the classroom, and she looks at me, and she says, are you Pete Gallego? And so I, of course, am feeling pretty good, right? So I actually get down on one knee, but I straighten up, you know, and I get down on one knee to talk to her, and I say, yeah, I'm Pete Gallego. And the next question comes, and she says, so, what does it feel like to be named after a school? So, having been named after a school, I will tell you that you keep grounded every day, and you go forth, and you do the very, very best job that you can, knowing that in the final analysis, you really are a catalyst for making our kids the best that they can be. And somewhere in your classroom, there's a future scientist, a future teacher, a future physician, a future president, a future senator, a future anything. Because those little minds that you are now molding are the minds that are going to run the world in just a matter of a few short years. They would tell me that time would fly really quickly, and I never believed it. I never thought I was going to get older. But I look at Nicolas, and that little boy was 7 pounds and 7 ounces the day that he was born when I held him the very first time. I used to play with his feet, and now his feet smell. And so, I can't really do that anymore, right? Se pasan los años. But understand that while this may be just another year for many in the profession, for those kids, this is the only senior year that they have, or the only fourth grade year that they have, or the only And so every day is such a tremendously important. So I have the privilege now, I want to say thank you for letting me be your congressman and letting me spend a few minutes with you. And I want to introduce somebody that I think makes a huge difference, because the truth is that a school district and an administration can make your life easy or they can make your life hard. They can help you succeed, or there are those districts where they stand in the way. In Eagle Pass, as you saw from the video, they don't stand in your way. Te dan vuelo. They give you speed, they give you encouragement, they push you to be even better than you think you can be. And the person who leads that, and who leads by example, and who does a phenomenal job of leading this district, is Gilberto Gonzalez. And so, Superintendent Gonzalez, por favor, take it away, and thank you so much for having me.
Good morning. Is this the best district ever? I mean, how do we do it? To get Mr. Pete Gallego to come and join us on this great day. Let's give him a big hand. Mr. Salcedo introduced the board members, so I want to introduce my team also. And they do an amazing job, starting with Mr. Ismael Mijares, Deputy Superintendent for Business and Finance. Mr. Eduardo Treviño, Deputy Superintendent for District Operations. Mr. Samuel Mijares, Deputy Superintendent for Curriculum and Instruction. Mr. Jesus Costilla, Executive Director for Human Resources. And to my right, the rest of the Central Office Administrators, Directors, and Coordinators, would you please stand? All secondary principals, please stand. All elementary campus principals, please stand. And the foundation, the early childhood campus principals. The beginning of a new school year is always exciting. Students are excited because they haven't been able to wear those brand new tennis shoes, but on the first day they'll wear them, okay? Teachers are excited, you know, because they're coming back to do what they do best, and that's teach. Let's give you a big hand. As I was coming in this morning, one male teacher met me outside and said, I'm glad to be back. It's great to be back. And I said, you're excited? He goes, yes, I'm tired of watching reruns of Law and Order. I said, okay. For the females, how many of you watch Dr. Oz? Raise your hand. Dr. Oz, there you go. How many of your husbands or significant others are upset at you because you watched Dr. Oz? Raise your hand. I'm raising my hand. I hope that this motivation, I hope that this day, this morning, the excitement, I hope it carries over during the rest of the school year. And like Mr. Salcedo said, and also Pete Gallego, not everything will be rosy. And there'll be days, you know, when you'll question, you know, why am I here? But that's the time that you have to regroup and say,
You know, I know why I'm here, because I'm a teacher and I do the best job ever. To those of you who are new, welcome to this exemplary district. And again, congratulations for joining a district where all schools met the standard. Let's give you a big hand. To the new teachers, I ask that you bring a fresh perspective and optimism to our mission to prepare every single student for success. Teachers, I want you to know how proud I am of your hard work and dedication. You have the most important job and the most difficult, and I'm especially honored to work with you. This year, I stand before you, just like last year and the year before, to ask you to help me with a new task. And the new task, of course, as was mentioned by our board president, is that we expect success. We expect success and nothing less. We're all accountable. I'm accountable to the board. The cabinet is accountable to me. The principals and supervisors are accountable to the cabinet. The teachers are accountable to the principals and the students, of course. So expecting success, we can get to the next level. I believe we're in the best position to move to the next level. Over the past 2 years, we have accomplished a great deal together, supported by a school board and a community that places tremendous hope and faith in us. And I want to take this time right now to recognize our board president, Mr. Ignacio Saucedo, and all of the board members for always advocating for our teachers and students, ensuring that they have all the resources required to succeed. Let's give them a big hand, please. Today, I ask you to reflect. To reflect on why you became a teacher. You could have chosen any other profession. However, you chose to be a teacher. In your reflection, I ask that you do not see students with limitations, but rather with possibilities. And the possibilities are limited only by the imagination. And Pete Gallego mentioned this. You have to see each student as the next president of the United States. You have to. You cannot shortchange them. As a teacher, your students are constantly learning from you. However, chances are most students won't remember all of the amazing lessons that you created. They might not remember how organized your bulletin board was, but they will remember you. They will remember your kindness and your empathy. They will remember your care and your concern. They'll remember that you took the time to listen to them. They'll remember that you stopped them one day in the hall and you asked them how they were doing when they really needed for someone to ask. That's you. In closing, I thank you again for the outstanding job that you do, for the educational opportunities that you provide to the children of this community. This is going to be the best school year yet. I have a very good feeling that this is going to be the best year ever. Thank you. Have a great year.
Thank you so much, Mr. Gonzalez. Get up, get out, and go get it. Enriched, elevated, and empowered is exactly what the youth and adult audiences feel after listening to one of Layman A. Hicks' transformative talks. A 23-year young bachelor's and master's degree graduate of Florida State University, Layman was a pivotal player on campus, serving as student body president, which entailed him managing and overseeing a $10.3 million budget, as well as cultivating campus leaders. Laman A. Hicks is the author of A Treasure Chest of Motivation, 8 Jewels of Wisdom for a Young Adult Success, and co-author of Unleash the Passion of Your Purpose and Ignite Your Dreams, How to Build and Accelerate Your Life as a Top-Notch Student. Hicks believes in paving the way for others younger than him so that they too can use their gifts, talents, and abilities. As a result, he founded the Laman A. Hicks Scholarship Fund, which funds an annual scholarship to first-generation students entering a 2- or 4-year college or university. Pursuing his mission has not come without obstacle, but his resilience, hope, confidence, and determination is what keeps Laman A. Hicks focused on maximizing his potential and being the absolute best person that he can be, a message he inspires others with all across our nation. Please help me welcome our very special guest, Laman A. Hicks.
Test. I need everybody on your feet right now, please. Everyone on your feet. Testing. Chuck. And I want you to do exactly what I do. Here we go. Do what I do. Right, just do what I do, just do like this. Now we're gonna switch it up, here we go. Go. Switch it up, here we go. Hey. Switch it up. Now just do like this. Rock, right? Go ahead, give yourself some round of applause. Take a seat. If you're ready to have a great time, let me hear you say, oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
If you're ready to have a great time, let me hear you say, oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Then I need you to repeat after me, please say, I feel good.
I feel good.
Say, I feel great.
I feel great.
I'm wide awake.
I'm ready to shake.
Shake and bake. Say, I'm ready to have some fun. Because I feel good. Real good. Real good. Say, I feel fantastic. Now turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor. Say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Say, I don't know about you.
I really don't know about you.
But I've just come to tell you that I. You got to say that with some sass. Say, I. Tell them, say, I look better than you do. Give yourself some round of applause. Ladies and gentlemen, it was a teacher that made me believe that I was somebody, that I was somebody when I came, I would be a better somebody when I leave, that I was powerful and strong, and that I had people to see, things to do, that I deserved the education that I received. It was a teacher that made me believe that I was somebody, and that it was somebody who needs me. As was mentioned, my name is Laman Hicks. That's Laman as in layman's terms. I am only 27 years young, right? So I'm not going to stand up here as if I know it all, as if I have this thing called life all figured out, because I don't. You see, I'm still learning, and I believe that the more you learn, the more you realize how much more there is to learn. Somebody say, oh yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I believe the more you learn, the more you realize how much more there is to learn. So in essence, no one knows it all. But here's what I do know. I know that this is the best district ever. I know this, that there is no other place that I would rather be right now at this moment than here with you all. Aww. I know this, that if you listen to the words that I'm going to share with you, I'll help you believe that it's possible, and I'll help you give, I'll give you tools that I believe that you all need in order to let your light shine. I know this. It wasn't always this way. In fact, growing up, had you been there watching me grow up, you would have noticed a young man who was hurting inside. You see, I was raised by my grandmother and grandfather. And after 25 years of marriage, I had to watch my grandmother and grandfather get a divorce because he cheated on her. Had you been there watching me grow up, you'd have noticed a young man who was scared, terrified, worried to death whether or not my mom would go to prison. You see, my mom found her husband cheating on her, so she tried to kill him. Had you been there watching me grow up, you'd have noticed a young man scared, terrified, worried to death whether or not my aunt would live. You see, my aunt found her husband cheating on her. She confronted him. He choked her out, and he left her there for dead. But luckily, she is alive today. See, but what you really would have noticed was a young man who was hurting inside. My dad wasn't there for me. And I used to think that I was the only kid in the world who didn't have a father figure in his life growing up. I had to watch my peers every day get dropped off by their mom and their dad, but my dad, he wasn't there. I could vividly remember calling my dad up and saying, "Hey, Dad, I want to hang out with you. Would you come pick me up?" And he was like, "Yeah, Layman, I'll be there to pick you up." And I was so excited, like a kid in a candy store. Yes, my dad's coming to hang out with me, but he never came. I called my dad back up. I said, "Dad, I thought you said you were going to pick me up." He said, "Layman, something came up, but I'll be there the next time." "But Dad, you always tell me you'll be there the next time. You always say that to me. Are you sure? Dad, are you going to come the next time?" See, my dad told me that he would be there. He never came. As a kid growing up, as you can conclude, I didn't have a positive male role model in my life. And so when I got to middle school, I began to wear my pants down low. I was cursing, instigating fights, bullying others, doing things to be liked by people who didn't even care about me as an individual. But I learned. And as I'll share with you, you see, our environment makes up who we are, but we don't have to allow our environment to dictate who we are. And so I realized that we're going to have some challenges in our lives, but that shouldn't stop us from pursuing those big goals. That we're going to have some setbacks in our life. That shouldn't stop us from pursuing our dreams. That we're going to make some mistakes. That we're going to fall down. We're going to have all these things. I realized that even despite that, despite having obstacles, despite having challenges, that I am still, and you all are too, because teachers are the bomb.com. Repeat this, please. Say, "Yes,
yes.
I'm the bomb.com." Say it like you mean it. Say, "Yes,
I'm
the bomb.com." Tell your neighbor. Say, "Neighbor."
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh.
Say, "Neighbor."
Neighbor.
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 Say, "You're cool.
You're cool.
You're awesome.
You're awesome.
But I'm the bomb.com." Yeah, right there. So here's the deal. There's three things today that I want to share with you that I believe if you apply to your life, you will let your light shine. Three things. Everybody say three.
Three.
Three key things that I want to share. But before I share those things with you, we have to have a little fun. Can we have some fun? Yes or yes?
Yes.
You see, there's no involved in that, which means we are about to have some fun. I have to test your eyes and your ears to make sure you are ready for my message. So to test your eyes, every time that my hands cross like this, I need you to clap. Every time that my hands cross like this, I need you to clap. Every time that my hands cross, I need you to clap. Every time that my hands cross, you all do what? Very good, here we go. You're not ready. Here we go. You're still not ready. One more time. No. Right? All right, here we go. I said, when my hands cross, you clap. Not when I clap, you clap. You should have saw it. She was like, right? Hercules, Hercules! Right? Here we go. Gotcha. Now, I'm about to test your ears. I always get people on this one, so I'm gonna give you a teaser. Throughout the message, I may say the words, can you feel me? Now, when I say can you feel me, what I want you all to say is, yes, sir! Can you feel me?
Yes, sir!
Can you feel me? Throughout the message, I may say the words, got it. When I say got it, you say got it, I'll say good, got it. No, don't you say got it, I say got it. I mean, don't you say good, I say good. He's like, good. No. Got it. Good. Now, give yourself two claps. One, two. Half. So here's the half clap. It's just like this, right? You gotta do the hand motion. I want you to have a headache, okay? Two claps. One, two, half. Right? You didn't get it right. Two claps. Four. Six. 12. I think some of y'all need to go sit by some math teachers. Yeah. Two, one, two, half. I did hear a little clap up here now. Yeah, I heard it. Yeah, you're not gonna fool me, right? All right, as I said before, there's three things that I want to share with you all today. Everybody say three.
Three
key things that I want to share with you. The very first principle that I would like to share is that in life, you have to be positive. Somebody say be positive. Look, not everything that you want is going to go the way you want, but something that you want will. You have to be positive. You know, I am all too familiar about being positive because it was the 10th grade at Jefferson High School in Tampa, Florida, where I was accepted to the National Honor Society. How many of you all have ever heard of the National Honor Society? Please raise your hands. Yeah. So I was accepted to the National Honor Society. Now, at my high school, if you were part of the National Honor Society, you literally were the bomb.com, right? No one could tell you nothing. You were, I scared you, right? We were taught to believe that you would get a 4.0 GPA, you would walk across the stage at graduation in a white robe where everyone else walked across the stage in a blue robe. You would get into any college that you wanted to get into. And so when I received that letter that said, congratulations, Lehman Hicks, you've been accepted to the National Honor Society, I was like, yes, I'm in, a brother could chill. That's what I thought. I had a test. It was world history, 7th period of the day, last class after lunch. I didn't study. I created a cheat sheet. It was 7-point font. It was Times New Roman. It was very small, so only I could see it. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? Right? You better not know what I'm talking about. There was a student in my audience one time that I was at his school. I was like, you all know what I'm talking about. He was like, I'm like, dude, you're sitting right next to your teacher. Why are you telling on yourself, right? Now, my teacher was Mr. B. He was a heavyset guy, goatee, bald head. He walked around the room and was like, clear your desk. But I didn't have to cheat. He came to my row. I'm in the very last seat. There's 4 seats in front of me. No one else sitting there. He reached out. He gave me the test. I took the test. I put it on top of my cheat sheet. When I looked down, I noticed that I had every answer circled. I had his answer key. It doesn't get any better than that. Because how many of you all ever wish when you were in school you had the answer key to a test before? Raise your hands, please. Yeah, right? So now I had the answer key right there in front of me. There was one of two things that I could do. I could take this test or I could give it back. What do you think I did? I raised my hand. I said, Mr. B, I believe I have your answer key here. Now, Mr. B smiling from ear to ear because I'm being a good boy. I'm smiling from ear to ear because I'm being a good boy. He walks over to my desk. He goes to take up that test. And in the heat of the moment, I quickly forgot the cheat sheet. He says, you're cheating in my class. I said, no, I'm not cheating in your class. You're cheating in my class. No, I'm not cheating in your class. You are cheating in my class. No, I'm not cheating in your class, but I was. And what he said to me next, I'll never forget. He said, that's an F, not just on this test, but in my class. Hold up, player, hold up. Like, do you not know who I am? I'm Layman Hicks. I don't get F's. He said, Layman, you didn't think about that before you decided to cheat in my class, did you? 1 week went by. I called myself dumb, stupid. I said, how could you do that? 2 weeks went by. I said, you're dumb, you're stupid. How could you do that? On that second week, I received a letter that said, regretfully, Layman Hicks, we have to inform you, but you have been dismissed from the National Honor Society. They kicked the brother out. But what about my goals, my dreams, the 4.0 GPA, walking across that stage in a white robe where everyone else walked across the stage in a blue robe? What about getting into any college that I wanted to get into? All of that gone because of a dumb mistake. 3 weeks went by, I'm calling myself dumb and stupid. I'm saying, how could you do that? 4 weeks went by, 5 weeks went by, 6 weeks finally went by before I realized something that my grandmother used to say to me all the time. She'd say, baby, when you fall down, get back up. What? Literally, my grandmother would say that to me all the time. She'd be like, baby, when you fall down, get back up. And so I thought about that. Maybe my grandmother's right. Maybe she's right. You see, some of you are just like me. You're going to make some mistakes. You're going to have some obstacles in your life. You're going to fall down. But today, I've come all the way from Florida. Well, I come from California, but I live in Florida. But I've come all the way from California to tell you this. To get back up, that you have to be positive. And so I thought, well, who's very positive in life that I need to be positive? Who's very positive? And it hit me, Muhammad Ali. Y'all know who Muhammad Ali is, right? Yeah, right? World's greatest boxer. He would knock you out in a minute, right? Bam, right? Let me show you exactly what Muhammad Ali would do. You, come here. Yeah, come here. Yeah. How are you?
Good about yourself.
Yeah, I'm good. Don't run up on here like that, though, because I'm from the hood, so don't do that.
I'm from the hood, too.
Yeah, y'all. He says, I'm from the hood, too, right? So, so look, Muhammad Ali would do it like this, right? I said he would knock you out in a minute, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, right?
Right.
Yeah, let me get ready. Okay. Muhammad Ali would do it just like this. He'd say, I'm bad, I'm pretty, I must be bad. I've shaken up the world. Last night, I had a fight, and it was one heck of a rumble. I had to whoop Norman's butt for claiming he was the king of the jungle, right? This fight, I've wrestled with an alligator, I've tussled with the whale. I had to handcuff Lightning and put Thunder in jail. You know I'm bad. Man, I'm so fast, I can run through a hurricane and don't get wet. When you meet me, you'll pay your debt. See, I can drown a drink of water, kill a dead tree. Wait until you see Muhammad. Yes, Muhammad Ali was very positive. He never gave mental recognition to doubt, to fear, not anything. Fear is false evidence appearing real. Research says you were born with two fears in life, the fear of falling and the fear of loud noises. So anything else you create. So this whole thing about you being afraid of spiders, stop it. All right. But I have to be honest, I am still fearful today. There was a young lady in my audience one time. She walked up to me. She was like, oh my gosh, Layman. I was like, what? She's like, oh my gosh, Layman. I was like, what? She's like, you live in Tampa, Florida. I was like, yeah, yeah, I did. She's like, oh my gosh, Layman. I was like, what? She's like, that must mean you go to the beach a lot. I was like, no, I don't, because black people don't get in no water. For real, y'all, search. No, I'm not going to the beach, right? But on a serious note, you cannot be fearful, right? You cannot be fearful of anything, right? So this year, you may get some students in your class that are just, whoo, yeah, bless their heart, right? But so you got to take them to the next level. You may not take those students to the next level. That just may very well happen. You may not get the test scores that you're looking for. That may happen, right? But as my grandmother would say, she would say, baby, when you fall down,
you get up.
No, Norman, my grandmother didn't say it like that. She said, baby, put your hand right here, let's do the grandma, right? She said, baby, when you fall down,
get up.
No. You gotta do the grandma voice. She said, baby, when you fall down,
you get up.
So I realized that I needed to pick myself back up. And so by the time I graduated from high school, I graduated as the only African-American male in my graduating class with over a 4.0 GPA. I went to Florida State University, where I have a bachelor's and a master's degree. Today, at the age of 27, I am working on my doctorate degree. The reason that I tell you that, the reason that I tell you that is not to impress you, but to impress upon you that yes, your test scores may not come back the way you want them to. Yes, there may be some things in your life that's going on. There are obstacles, there are hurdles. But as my grandmother would say, when you fall down, get back up. And so I realized that I needed to be positive. And today I want you all to know to always this year be positive. Got it? Got it? Good. Now, point number two, everybody say two. Point number two that I want to share with you is that you have to be hungry. Now I know probably y'all are like, yeah, I'm hungry right now. Yeah, right? But in other words, what I'm trying to tell you is this. You know, Mr. Superintendent said to expect success, but today I'm going to tell you to have success. And in order to have success, you have to get up, get out, and go get it. Right? You see, because some people will tell you that good things come to those who wait. You heard that before? Raise your hands. Good thing. Garbage. Good things come to those who wait. Cool, that's fine. But great things come to those who get up, who get out, and who go get them. I don't want you just to have good things in your life this year as a school district. I don't want you just to have good things. I want you to have great things. The question, though, is do you want that for yourself? Get up. Get out. And go get it. You know, I like that part of my speech because it reminds me of the time when I was running to become the student body president at Florida State University. I was running to be the top student leader on the campus of 38,000 students, but they told me, Layman, you're not good enough. Layman, it'll never happen. Layman, what are you thinking? Well, I really wanted it. And as I campaigned across campus from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m., 12 days straight, two quotes stuck with me. The very first quote says this. It says, hard work will always beat talent when talent does not work hard. In other words, there are some people, some school districts that may have more smart students than you all will, more athletic students than you all have. But when you work hard, you can accomplish those goals and those dreams. The other thing that stuck with me was from an interview that I saw with Will Smith. And in that interview, Will Smith said this. He said, if you and I were on a treadmill together, either you're going to get off first or I'm going to die, because I will not allow you to outwork me. In other words, Will Smith was saying, we cannot allow anyone to outwork us at our goals, our dreams, whatever we want, we have to go get it today. I traveled with a pair of the shoes that I wore during my campaign in 2008 when I ran to become the student body president at Florida State University. And I traveled with these shoes to show students, and you all too, exactly what hard work looks like. This is a pair of the shoes that I wore in 2008 when I ran to become the student body president at Florida State University. This is hard work. This is hard work. I literally walked holes in my shoes to accomplish my goal and dream. Now, no, I'm not telling you that you have to walk holes in your shoes, but what I am telling you is that if you want to have success as a district, if you want to have success in your personal life, that you have to get up, you have to get out, and you have to go get it. Can you feel me? Can you feel me? Good. Now, point number three, everybody say three. Point number three is my favorite point. Point number three is this. Neutralize the weapons of mass distraction. Gotcha, right? Distraction. Now, I have to tell you, some people are going to be distracted by many things. Some people, they're distracted by Facebook and all these social media apps and Angry Bird and Flappy Bird and I hate birds, right? But let me tell you why, right? So it was April 2011. I was flown from Florida to California to work with 1,200 middle school student leaders, 6th, 7th, and 8th graders who were all fired up about leadership, passionate about leadership. And so I met this conference, right? I have on a brand new suit, brand new shoes. Ooh, a brother was fine, right? Yeah. I look like Usher, right? I had just finished speaking. There was a group of students that walked up to me and said, hey, Layman, we are about to board the bus and head to the beach. Would you like to come? Now, you know me and the beach. We don't get along like that, right? So I thought about it. I was like, you know what? Sure, why not? I have nothing else to do today. Sure, cool. And so I'm on the way to the beach with these students in California, right? And as I'm on the way to the beach in California with these students, I realized that I didn't have the opportunity to change my clothes. And so now I'm on the way to the beach in California in a suit. Who does that? This guy, right? So we get to the beach in California. At this particular beach in California, there's carnival rides, roller coasters, right? And so I'm having a great time. Students are coming up to me, telling me about their goals and dreams in life, telling me about the things that they want to accomplish in life. I mean, I'm really having a great time. As I'm sitting there talking to a group of students, I see this young man walking up towards me who had on long sleeves. And as he's walking towards me, I'm thinking to myself, what a fool. Who wears long sleeves to the beach? And then I remember, you have on a suit, right? So he walks up to me, he tells me about the fact that his mom or dad are getting a divorce. He tells me about the fact that he got caught stealing. He was hanging around the wrong crowd and people have told him that he'll never be anything in life. I said, let me stop you right there, because I used to steal too. When I was in the fourth grade, I used to walk into our school library, take a book off the shelf, put it in my pants, and walk out. Who steals free stuff? Scott, right? And who steals books? This guy, right? Like, I had goosebumps walking out, just walking out, right? Like, literally, like, seriously, Huckleberry Finn, all these different books, right? And so I told him, it's okay, pick yourself back up, you got this. He walks off, now I walk off. Now I'm talking to a new group of friends. Me and my friends right here, we're standing in line for a pirate ship ride that goes back and forth like this, right? We're standing in line, and as we're standing in line, I felt this warm spot on my arm, a bird had decided to crap on me. And y'all laughing. I was mad, like, how dare you, bird? How dare you crap on my brand new suit, okay? Like, how dare you, and how dare you, out of all the people at the beach, you crap on a black guy. I was upset, and this is what made it worse. There was this girl, she's like, oh my gosh, Layman, why are you so upset? When a bird craps on you, it means good luck. You and that bird about to get told off, okay? Yeah, you just get out of my face. But I heard this voice that said, Layman, that is a So I went back to doing what I was supposed to do, talking to students, having a great time. Me and my friends right here, we get on that ride, we get off. I see that young man again, the one with the long sleeves. And I looked at him, and I said, you can do it, and I walked off. I said, you can do it, and I walked off. I was on my way home back to Florida, checking my email for the very last time before the flight attendant said, turn your cell phones off, when I received an email from a young man named Jacob. The subject line said, you saved my life. So I opened the email. It says, Layman, you saved my life. He said, if you don't remember me, when I came up to talk to you, I had on long sleeves. It was to hide the cuts. I had been trying to kill myself. See, Layman, you saved my life. He said, you told me that I can do it. No one's ever told me that I can do it, and for that, I say thank you, because you saved my life. And right then at that moment, I began to get teary-eyed, because I thought about the fact that right before that happened, a bird crapped on me. And I was mad, and I was upset. But I began to wonder, where would Jacob be today had I allowed that bird to distract me from doing what I was supposed to do? And then I started to think, you know what? Some people are just like birds. They only come into your life to crap on you. Yes, yes, it is the truth. Yes, there are some people who come into your life, they tell you that you're not good, they try to make you feel like you're not great. There are so many people who will make you feel like that. Heck, there are some students who will make you feel like that. I have to talk my wife off a cliff all the time. She's a first grade teacher. And literally, she was teaching, last year she taught second grade, and there was this one kid who just always made her feel like crap. And I was like, it's okay, it's not you, baby, it's not you, okay? It's him, all right, it's him. But look, there are some people who will come into your life to make you feel that you're not the bomb.com. But today, I am here to remind you that yes, teachers are the bomb.com. So today, I want to remind you that in order to let your light shine, You cannot allow the birds to come into your life to crap on you. In order to let your light shine, you cannot get worked up over the distractions in your life. If you want something, you got to get up, get out, and go get it. If you want something, when you fall down, because you're going to fall down, you're going to have some obstacles, you're going to have some hurdles in your life, but when you fall down, as my grandmother would say, baby, when you fall down, ooh, y'all sound beautiful, right? So now, I just share with you three things. I share with you that you have to be positive. I share with you that you have to be hungry. And I share with you that you need to neutralize the weapons of mass destruction. Now I'm going to share something with you that's going to shock you. The three things that I just shared with you, they don't mean anything. It means nothing. And it means nothing if you don't have the love and support of family and friends. July 11, 2010, I was home. I was chilling, playing Call of Duty. You know, that's what teenagers do, right? It was my cousin's 22nd birthday. I didn't pick up the phone and call her and say happy birthday. I didn't text her and say happy birthday. I didn't even write on Facebook and say happy birthday. Fast forward, 4 days later. July 15, 2010, I'm home. I'm chilling. I'm playing Call of Duty. 6:30 p.m. in the evening, my aunt calls. She says, Layman, she's dead. What? My niece, your cousin, she gone, she dead. What I gathered from what my aunt was sharing with me through her tears was that my cousin, who had just turned 22 years young 4 days prior, passed away from a massive heart attack. The following week, my family and I, we have to bury her, and I'm standing at her casket. And I'm asking myself, how and why? But the questions aren't being answered. And I try to think back to the last time that I said, I love you, Tor. And I couldn't give myself an answer. And I begin to get mad with myself. Because how dare you, Layman? How dare you not let your family and friends know how much they mean to you? How dare you not let the people in your life know how much they mean to you? You see, you think they know that you love them. You think they know that you appreciate them, but do they really know? I begin to get mad with myself. I need everybody's eyes closed right now. Everyone's eyes closed. What I want you to do is that person that you were just thinking about, I want you to take out your cell phone. I want you to text that person this simple phrase, thank you for what you mean to me, I love you. Take out your cell phone, text that person that you were just thinking about and say, thank you for what you mean to me, I love you. Come here. Yeah. How are you?
I thought you were bringing up during the Hungry Bit.
What's your name?
Tony.
Who were you thinking about?
My dad.
Okay, cool. What school do you teach at?
Sam Houston.
Okay. Now, I have to be honest with you because some of you all are going to like text somebody and they're going to text you back and say, what did you do? All right? Just let them know you did nothing wrong. So I have Tony here from Sam Houston, right? Yeah, woo! Tony was thinking about his dad, right? So what Tony's about to do, if I can get this microphone on. Tony is going to call his dad right now on speaker, and he's going to tell his dad that he loves him in front of all of us. All right? You ready?
I don't have his number.
No, oh, I was like, what? He's like, I don't have his number. So you got to put it on speaker. Right. And just let him know, you know, dad, I appreciate everything that you do for me. I love you. I just want to say thank you.
Thank you.
Is it ringing?
It's ringing.
It's ringing.
Let us hear the ring.
He's very vulgar.
It's okay.
Please leave your message.
Leave a voicemail.
Great job.
All right, sit down. So, I don't know who it is that you need to share that with, but today, I'm encouraging you to let the people in your life know how much they mean to you. See, because we never know. We never know when it's going to be someone's last day here. And rather than be like me and not let the people in your life know how much they mean to you, today I want to let you know, to let those in your life know how much you appreciate them, that you're thankful for them. July 20th, a guy walked into a movie theater and took the lives of some individuals, 12 individuals. December 14th, a guy walked into a school and took the lives of young kids. See, people leave this world every single day. And rather than be like me and play the game after the fact and say, I wish I could have, or I did this, I wish that, and don't do it. Just go ahead and let the people in your life know how much they mean to you right now. That could be a coworker, that could be a student that's going to walk into your classroom this year. You never know. There was a young lady in my audience one time, she raised her hand and she says, my brother has never told me that he loves me. I said, well, when you get home, tell him. She said, he's right there. I said, yo, tell your sister that you love her. He said, I love you. She said, say it louder. I said, oh my gosh. So he said, I love you. He got up and went in front of the entire school and gave her a hug. 2 weeks later, I'm at Junction City High School in Junction City, Kansas. There's 1,800 students in the gym. I'm standing in the middle of the gym. I'm trying to figure out who it is that I want to bring up to call. There's this young man. I just felt this strong connection with him. And so I asked him as he's walking up towards me, I asked, you know, who are you going to call? And no lie, he said this. He said, my sperm donor. And I knew exactly where he was going with that because I used to call my dad the exact same thing. He wasn't a dad to me. He wasn't a father to me. He was just a man that helped bring me into this world. The young man walks up. He calls his dad. His dad says, what? He says, dad, I just wanted to call and let you know that I love you. His dad said, what? He says, dad, I just wanted to call and let you know that I love you. You begin to hear his dad's voice crack up. And he says, son, I love you too. I get back to my hotel room that night and I'm checking my emails and Facebook messages and tweets from students. And there was one message in particular that stood out to me that happened to be from that young man who told me that in 5.5 years, he hadn't talked to his dad. But he had the courage to come before 1,800 people and let his dad know that he loved him. There's a young lady, she sends me an email, it's 3 a.m. in the morning. 3 a.m. in the morning, she sends this email to me. She says, Layman, I was done. I was going to commit suicide. I had the pills ready to go. I didn't care about that motivation stuff. Layman, you see, you came to my school. I bought a copy of your book. The book that she's talking about is the book that all of you all received today. She says, I didn't care about that book. And as you probably browse through the book, you can notice that there's over 450 quotes that I wrote over a year and a half that I put in this book. She says, I didn't care about that motivation stuff, Layman. I took your book, I slung it across the room, it hit the wall, and it landed to page 3. If you go to page 3 in that book, you'll notice in big bold letters, it says, there is too much purpose in your life to give up right now. Keep going, you've got this. She said she took that book, she folded it up, she took those pills, she flushed them down the toilet. I am happy to report to you all that that young lady is starting her junior year at a college in Kansas. Now, why do I tell you that? Why do I tell you that? I tell you that because of this. You see, you're going to have an impact on people and you don't even know that you're going to make an impact on them. There's going to be a coworker who may come to work who's having a rough time at home. And the fact that you say hello in the hallway, the fact that you smile, the fact that you say, what's up? It may brighten their whole day. There's going to be a student who's going to walk into your classroom going through a really tough time, and the fact that you give them love and care, it's going to make their whole world better. You see, you make an impact and you don't even know it. You make an impact and you don't even know it. It's one of the reasons why I believe that teachersarethebomb.com, because I know you guys make an impact. And sometimes you don't get the things that you're deserving. You sometimes, people don't go out of their way to appreciate you the way they should appreciate you. But today, I want to let you know that I appreciate you. You see, because it was teachers that made me believe that I was somebody. And even though I used to be one of those kids who was crazy, and I used to talk all the time, even though I got good grades, I used to talk all the time. Yeah, I was one of them. Got C's and D's and conned up because I talked all the time. Well, today, I get paid to talk. And so, you're gonna have students who may just be like me. Just shut up, right? But this is what we're gifted at, you know? So, here's the deal. Up here, I have the very first book that I ever wrote. It's called A Treasure Chest of Motivation, 8 Jewels of Wisdom for a Young Adult Success. This book right here. Let's talk about birds, right? Those birds that crap on you. This book right here. In 2007, I wrote a list of goals that I wanted to accomplish in my life, and one of them was that I wanted to be an author. I told my mom, hey, mom, I'm gonna write a book one day. She said, boy, you ain't gonna write no book. Now I have 4. All right? So, I have some wristbands right here, too, and I have some on sale in the back as well, but they say, get up, get out, and go get it. Yes, I'm thebomb.com, and don't be a bird. All right? So, the question that I have for you all is, who wants this? Who wants this? I really want to know who wants it. Whenever you want something, get up, get out, and go get it, right? Yeah. All right. So, in closing, I want to read you all a story. And then I'm going to play a song, and I want all of us to get up and kumbaya with each other, okay? All right. But this story is called The Bracelet, and it's by Elizabeth Ballard. It reads, on the first day of school, Jean Thompson told students, boys and girls, I love you all the same. I have no favorites. Of course, she wasn't being completely truthful. Teachers do have favorites. And what is worse, most teachers have students that they just don't like. Teddy Stallard was a boy that Miss Thompson just didn't like. He didn't seem interested in school. There was a deadpan, blank expression on his face, and his eyes had a glossy, unfocused appearance. When she spoke to Teddy, he always answered in monosyllables. His clothes were musty and his hair was unkempt. He wasn't an attractive boy, and he certainly wasn't likable. Teachers have records, and Jean Thompson had Teddy's. First grade, Teddy shows promise with his work and attitude, but poor home situation. Second grade, Teddy could do better. Mother is seriously ill. He receives little help at home. Third grade, Teddy is a good boy, but too serious. He is a slow learner. His mother died this year. Fourth grade, Teddy is very slow, but well-behaved. His father shows no interest. Christmas came, and the boys and girls brought presents and piled them on Miss Thompson's desk. They were all in brightly colored paper except for Teddy's. His was wrapped in a brown paper bag, held together by scotch tape. On the paper, he had written the simple words, for Miss Thompson, from Teddy. When she opened Teddy's presents, out fell a gaudy rhinestone bracelet with half the stones missing and a bottle of cheap perfume. When the other boys and girls began to giggle, Miss Thompson had enough sense to silence them by immediately putting on the bracelet and putting some of the perfume on her wrist. Holding up her wrist for the other children to smell, she said, doesn't it smell lovely? Isn't this bracelet pretty? And the children, taking their cue from the teacher, readily agreed. At the end of the day, when all the children left, Teddy Linger came over to her desk and said, Miss Thompson, you smell just like my mother. And her bracelet looks real pretty on you, too. I'm glad you like my presence. When Teddy left, Miss Thompson got down on her knees and asked God to forgive her. The next day that the children came, Jean Thompson was a different teacher. She helped all children, but especially the slow ones, and especially Teddy Stallard. By the end of the school year, Teddy showed dramatic improvement. He had caught up with most of the students and was even ahead of some. She didn't hear from Teddy for a long time. Then one day, she received a note that read, Dear Miss Thompson, I wanted you to be the first to know. I will be graduating second in my high school class. Love, Teddy Stallard. 4 years later, another note came. Dear Miss Thompson, they just told me I will be graduating first in my class. I wanted you to be the first to know. The university has not been easy, but I like it. Love, Teddy Stallard. And 4 years later, dear Ms. Thompson, as of today, I am Theodore J. Staller, MD. How about that? I wanted you to be the first to know I'm getting married next month on the 27th, to be exact. I want you to come and sit where my mother would sit if she were alive. You are the only family that I have now. Dad died last year. Love, Teddy Staller. Ms. Thompson went to that wedding and sat where Teddy's mother would have sat. She deserved to sit there. She had done something for Teddy that he could never forget. Ladies and gentlemen, each day you make an impact on students and you don't even know you're making an impact. Today, I want to encourage you that as you go through life, as you go through this year, to always let your light shine.